For this video, we'll discuss temperature changes and how those can be used to predict the shift in equilibrium for a system. In order to predict the direction of shift for an equilibrium system, we have to know whether a reaction is endothermic or exothermic. So you have to be given either the sign of enthalpy or the value and sign of enthalpy. For this reaction, because we are breaking more bonds than we're making, this is predicted to be a positive enthalpy. And remember that that is called an endothermic reaction. And remember that endothermic means that heat is going into the system. And so the analogy that we can use is that heat is actually a substance in a chemical reaction. Anytime we have an endothermic reaction, we can think of heat as being a reactant. And in fact, I encourage you to physically write heat on the reactant side for an endothermic reaction. Once we know that, now we can view changes in temperature similar to changes in concentration. So if I increase temperature, that is the same as adding heat. Heat is a reactant here, and so adding or increasing the temperature for this system will force a shift to the right. Of course, the exact opposite. If I decrease the temperature, I'm removing heat. I'm removing a reactant, and so that's going to force it to shift back to the left to replace that reactant. So again, increasing temperature is the same as adding heat. And in this scenario, that heat is a reactant. Decreasing temperature, putting this reaction in an ice bath, for example, is the same as removing heat. And again, it's endothermic, so that's still the same as removing a reactant. So again, for endothermic systems, heat is a reactant, and we can predict shifts based on temperature changes there. So what about decreasing temperature or for exothermic reactions? Well, let's look at this same system, but reverse our reaction. If you remember from first semester in Hess's law, remember that one of the changes we could make was to reverse a reaction and then predict what would happen with enthalpy. Well, since I'm literally flipping where the reactants and products are, I'm literally reversing the direction of heat flow. Another way to think about it, in this reaction, I'm making more bonds than I'm breaking. It's a combination reaction. Anytime we make bonds, that is predicted to be exothermic. Remember, our initial version of this equation was endothermic. Now that we flipped it, this is now exothermic. And remember that exothermic reactions means that heat is being given off. And so as an analogy, we can think of heat as being a product. Now that we have heat as a substance in our chemical equation, we can think about what happens as we make temperature changes. So again, increasing temperature is the same as adding heat, but in this reaction or equation, that heat is a product. So remember, anytime we increased the amount of a product, our system had to shift in the reverse direction. And I know we already know the answer to it, but let's go through the motions anyway. For this system, if I decrease the temperature, if I put this in an ice bath, I'm effectively removing heat from the system. That's the same as removing a product. And whenever we remove a product, the system wants to shift to replace it. And so for this example, the system would have to shift to the right. So going back to our original endothermic reaction, notice in our summary here, when we increase temperature, this one went right. Going to the exothermic system, it should make sense that now when we increase temperature, this system goes to the left. And that's because heat is on the opposite side of the equation. So summary slide for you here, we've already written this, but just putting it here all in one place for you. But remember that when we change temperatures, we're not only causing a shift in the equilibrium, we are also changing the value of our equilibrium constant. So as an example, again, we don't typically do numbers or calculations in here, but looking at our ammonia equation, we're measuring temperature on the x-axis and our equilibrium constant on the y. So notice that as temperature increases, right, as temperature is increasing going to the right here, our K value is actually decreasing. And again, we can see those values over here in the table. So again, as temperature increases, our K value decreases. That can actually help us also determine whether a reaction is endo or exothermic. The other way we can approach the problem is if we know a system is endo or exothermic, we can predict what would happen to the K value with each change. So here we have an endothermic system. Again, heat is a reactant, and we know it's endothermic because we're given a positive value here. We know that if we increase temperature, this is going to force our system to shift to the right. And when it does that, we're going to get more products and less reactants, and therefore our K value will go up. Of course, when we decrease temperature, we know this is going to shift back to the left, meaning that we're going to decrease products and increase reactants at the same time. When both of those changes happen, we see a decrease in our equilibrium constant. When we are describing exothermic reactions, of course, heat is a product. And so we know that when we increase temperature, that's the same as increasing a product. Our system's going to shift back to the left to undo that. When it shifts left, our products decrease and our reactants increase. When both of those happen, our K value decreases. Again, notice that that's the opposite for an endothermic reaction. Again, for exothermic, when we decrease the temperature of the system, it's going to end up shifting right. When it shifts right, we increase products and decrease reactants. When that happens, we increase our K value. Now, the application of this can be carried over to lab, where if we have colored substances, we can change the temperature, either hot or cold, for a given reaction, and then we can interpret whether that system is endo or exothermic. So for this scenario, we have complex ions again. We would start with a blue reactant, put it in some water, and we'd have to tell you that the product is pink here because, of course, once this system comes to equilibrium, we have everything in our reaction container together. So notice at room temperature, our equilibrium mixture is purple in color. And that's because we have both our reactants and our products present at the same time. So what we want to figure out here is when we heat our reaction over a Bunsen burner, notice that this looks a little bit more blue than our original purple color. And so that means with heat, this reaction shifted back to the left. To confirm that, we also put our reaction in an ice water bath. Notice we see a lot more pink here. So with the removal of heat or making this reaction cold, it shifted to the right. So with all of this information, again, with the heat, it shifted left. With cold or removal of heat, it shifted to the right. Putting all of this together, we can then determine that this reaction must be exothermic. So realizing that putting heat on the product side matches the observations we see down here. that as we increase temperature, because heat's on the product side, that forces our reaction to shift in the backwards direction toward the blue. But when we put it in an ice bath, we decrease the temperature, we removed heat, our reaction shifted to the right. And so you can use color changes of reactions in lab to predict whether a reaction is endo or exothermic. And so our final answer for this one is exothermic.